So, Judge, in the last segment, you walked us through the sort of the conventional understanding of the FDR court packing scandal that took place in the more or less the mid-1930s, wherein FDR supposedly wanted to expand the size of the court in response to the court's, I guess, intransigence about signing off or validating many of the aspects of the New Deal. The conventional wisdom is that this failed. It was a devastating blow to FDR politically. It launched sort of a conservative, transpartisan, if you will, a coalition that had some durability over the following decades. Your research suggests that, in fact, our hindsight of this period is off.
Yes. So the insight that I brought to this, or the thing that inspired me to look at this, was the fact that in March of 1937, not even a month after Roosevelt proposed his supposed court packing plan, Congress passed a little notice law to increase the pension of Supreme Court justices if they retired. This seemed absurdly odd to me. Why, in the midst of this court packing fight about big national issues dealing with the nature of the independent judiciary and the president and congressional power over law and the Constitution, would they pass this little thing that seemed to increase Supreme Court pensions? What I found out, though, in my further research, is that Roosevelt's plan itself was actually also focused on judicial retirement and was also aimed at increasing Supreme Court pensions. And furthermore, that the seemingly mundane issue of judicial retirement has been absolutely essential in the battle over independent courts over the past 200 years in America. So if I could, I can step back a little bit further and go back to the sort of constitutional issue with judicial retirement.
Yeah, let's do. And it's sort of, I mean, it's fascinating. And it's the idea that something so material, I guess, and in some respects banal as we look across history, right? And when we're talking about, you know, less than a dozen people, when we're talking about in terms of justices anyways, that something so material and practical could have such implications. But yeah, tell us the history of judicial pensions in this country.
Yeah, it is a surprising thing, but it is important to remember that the founders did consider this issue. They were very aware of what we would today call incentives, what they might call material motives, for anyone serving in office, and they were concerned about the ability of Congress, the president, the courts, to manipulate people using these material motives. So in the Federalist Papers, Alexander Hamilton notes that the problem of what to do when a judge retires or gets too old to serve in a bench was troublesome. One, you couldn't have a set retirement age, he thought, because there was lots of productive older justices, and you couldn't have Congress and the president decide when someone got too old and kick them out, because that would be politicized. And you couldn't, in his mind, have a pension, because a pension was viewed in this sort of corrupt British constitutional system where the favors of certain people were bought off by the crown. And they think, well, a pension is sort of a favor given for a lack of work and was indicative of an aristocratic mindset. That's how they viewed pensions in general. So he said, Alexander Hamilton, the Federalist Papers basically said, just let them die on the bench, more or less. He understood, we understand now, the life expectancy was lower, yes. But the main issue wasn't that they died younger. It was that they thought, we have no way to get them off, so let's just let them periodically sort of die, and that will have a natural turnover effect. But the problem of older and mentally incapacitated justices remained, and people struggled with it for some time. So finally, in the late 1860s, when a radical Republican Congress working on Reconstruction of the South, was very concerned about Democratic justices in that era overturning some of their laws that were trying to help civil rights and protect the interests of freed blacks and African Americans in the South. They instituted the first pension act for Supreme Court justices that allowed them, once they retired at age 70, to collect their full pension and keep that after they had left the bench. The goal was pretty explicit. It was to try to move some of these older Democratic justices off the bench, and it worked. There were two justices that took the new pension and retired pretty soon afterwards that were also mentally not entirely there and that were looking to leave the bench but had refused to because of the lack of a salary. Unfortunately, once this pension was in place and did sort of solve that issue to some extent of the mentally incapacitated or excessively old justices, it opened up the other issue that Congress could manipulate this pension. There's a clause in the Constitution that says the salary of judges in the federal judiciary should not be reduced by Congress, but it doesn't say anything about their pension. So now this thing, just like the original founders understood that you didn't want them manipulating the salary of judges, now you open up this other problem where they could manipulate the pensions. As I mentioned in the piece, twice over the next 50 years, they gave two different justices a set time to resign if they were going to collect their pension. Congress actually passed a law that said, if you resign in the next 30 days, you get a full pension. If not, wow, we'll see. And the justices took them up on it. So it opened up this danger of politicization that continued through the next 50, 60 years. And if you want, I could also go into more details of how they tried to fix this in the lower courts. But it eventually helped inspire Roosevelt's plan.
Well, we just have 2 minutes left, so let's jump forward and to how this relates to FDR's plan and where it takes us today.
Yes. Okay. So in 1932, Congress passed a Little Notice Act in the middle of the Depression, cutting Supreme Court justice pensions, which they saw just as a budget maneuver. But other people understood this meant that they probably wouldn't resign. Their salaries were higher and protected, their pensions weren't. And so this is exactly why Roosevelt didn't see any retirements for the first 5 years in the presidency, unlike the longest period without that over the past 100 years. And so he knew the problem was these judges weren't collecting their pensions. And he was proposing, as part of his plan, increase the pension benefits, but also he threatens to appoint an extra justice for every judge who doesn't retire and take their pension. But he gives them an out. He says, listen, if you take the pension, you can move off the bench. The court will stay at 9, and now we'll have regular turnover at the bench because you're just kind of being encouraged to push out. And this retirement reform was part of his plan. He said, this is pretty much what the Republicans did in the 1860s. We did it a little bit in the 19-teens in the lower courts, and I'm just proposing it here, which is why many people thought it might actually work.
And so it was a lot less controversial at the time than we, I think, look back upon, as you write. And so, So where does that bring us today? What's the status of pensions, and where? How can that bring us to a different solution?
So the point where we're at today is we sell these pensions that are potentially manipulable by Congress and the presidency, and we should rightfully be concerned about how Congress can use these in the future to manipulate the number of people, the people on the Supreme Court. We also have the other problem, what Hamilton identified to a certain extent, is that now that they're pensions, people can choose when to retire. So these justices, if they're a conservative or a liberal, they can wait till conservative or liberal president, and they can retire. Right. They're basically someone who replaces them. And we worry now about very long terms, basically a seat being conservative or liberal for a generation. The counter proposal is to have something like a set term on the bench. So these people can't replace themselves. We don't have to worry about pension manipulations, and Congress and the presidency can't influence when or where people leave their seats in the Supreme Court.
Well, I, for one, am a fan of that 18-year term limit, and I am maybe somewhat convinced by the arguments that threat and court packing will get you that term limit, but there is some, again, transpartisan support for that. Judge Glock, it's a fascinating story. I know that you're going to be writing more about this. Thanks so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.